Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. You could have been anywhere in the world, but you're here with us. This is the Maverick Podcast. I'm your host, DJ Maverick. Today, we have a super talented guest, the one and only artist, Jose Scott. Welcome to the pod.
Thanks for having me, man.
Very cool. I'm super excited. I've been checking you out on IG, all your projects and everything. So before we get started with everything, because we're going to talk about a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
For the 1% of the people out there that don't know who you are, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, my name is Jose Scott. I'm from Oklahoma, south side of Oklahoma City, born and raised. I'm a graffiti artist / muralist. I work at the Plaza Walls. I'm the manager at the gallery, and I help run the Plaza Walls, the murals and stuff.
Cool.
I'm a muralist, artist, graphic designer, whatever.
Awesome. Yeah. And NFT artist.
NFT artist.
We're going to dive into the NFT because I'm a super believer in that. I think it's the future. And I think it's a great way for artists to get paid, right?
Exactly. It's definitely the way. People say it might be the way. It's definitely the way.
Yeah, for sure. So tell me a little bit about sort of the younger Jose. Like, what were you into? Were you into sports? Were you always into, like, you know, sketching, art, that sort of thing?
So funny enough, when I was younger, I didn't like to draw.
Really?
Yeah, I didn't like to do any of that. I used to play a lot of football, a lot of soccer.
Okay.
A lot of basketball. And then I used to watch a lot of cartoons like Digimon, Yu-Gi-Oh!
Okay.
Pokemon, like the usual, you know?
Yeah.
And I guess once I got into middle school, I got influenced by all of my family because my family is like gangsters, cholos.
Oh, really?
So, I was like, oh, that looks cool. You get to write your name on walls. All right.
So you were influenced with like the whole South OKC graffiti scene, like that whole thing.
Yeah. It definitely started ramping up when I was in middle school and people started making like crews and stuff. And I was like, I don't want to be left behind, so I want to do it. So I got to doing it and wasn't the best thing to do, but it was a life experience.
What middle school were you?
Roosevelt.
Roosevelt. Okay.
Yeah.
So you got like caught a couple of times doing the graffiti stuff or what?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It wasn't my proudest moment in life, but I definitely felt like I had to go through it to kind of check myself to be like, all right, I'm not immortal.
I see. So we were talking about your name right before we got started.
Yeah.
And I was curious if that was like your artist name, right? Like Jose Scott, right? Like that's a unique combination.
Yeah.
But then we got to talking and you said, so your mom is white and then your dad is from Mexico?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mexican.
Cool. We're talking about the whole Selena, like you're not Mexican enough for the Mexicans. You're not white enough for the whites, right?
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about that. Like what was the culture like growing up with both sides or how did that go for you?
Yeah. When I was younger, like I said, we would always go to Mexico with my dad. It was like literally every summer, every Christmas we would go. Like I was saying, every time we went, they would call us bolillos. But I definitely got used to it. I didn't like it at first because I definitely want to represent my culture as best as I can. And I just started to learn to deal with it. You can't really control other people's thoughts and sayings. Right. So,
did you grow up speaking both Spanish and English?
Yeah.
So you got like full-blown like Spanish fluent?
Well, I don't want to say fluent, but
I
could definitely hold a conversation, but then there's times where it'll get tricky.
Yeah. What about music? Did you grow up sort of like in both sides?
Yeah. Los Tigres del Norte. I used to always like listen to that. My mom used to always listen to, there's some other like old school, like Mexican bands that my mom used to listen to. Los Ringos.
Rileros?
Yeah. And like just banda stuff.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah. That's pretty cool that you got to experience that because sometimes when you have a mixed family like that, sometimes you lean more towards like one culture or the other.
It was definitely more lean towards the Mexican side than the white side. Yeah.
Okay.
But I'm definitely proud of both for sure.
Very cool. So middle school, you got into some little trouble. We go to high school. What was high school like for you?
I feel like high school was probably worse.
Worse?
Yeah. I mean, I didn't get caught up with police or anything, but I was definitely like didn't care. Like I didn't care about education. I didn't care about any of that. I just wanted to become a graffiti artist.
I see.
But in the bad way, not in a good way.
Yeah.
I was just like anarchy, stuff like that. I didn't care about the system or none of that. Like I was telling you, I got kicked out of Grant. I went to, well, they were wanting me to go to Seaworth. I hated Seaworth. I have a bunch of friends in Seaworth.
Oh, yeah.
I knew going there would probably be the worst decision of my life. So I waited to get accepted to Metro Tech, and they finally accepted me. And
very cool. Did you do graphic design or something? Or?
No, actually.
You're throwing all kinds of curveballs.
Yeah,
here,
yeah. Like. So actually, I tried. I didn't get accepted because it was a hot, everybody wants to be in graphic design.
Sure.
So I actually went to culinary.
Really?
Yeah, I did culinary. Wow. Okay. And every year that I was there at Metro Tech, I did culinary.
That's cool.
So I think it was like 5 years.
So would you say that that's like another thing, another hobby or another thing that you enjoy? Like there's another side of you or what?
I don't know if I definitely love it, but I don't enjoy it because I worked at the Cheesecake Factory.
Okay.
And it definitely put that perspective away from me. I'm like, I don't want to be in the food business anymore. It's so hard.
Okay.
It's not worth it.
Yeah. So. But that's probably because you experience more like the fast. Like,
yeah. Yeah. Know, fast food. Pace. Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
What if it would have been like your own thing and you could have developed something?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. I do that at home now.
Oh, you do?
Yeah. I cook at home. We have HelloFresh. I don't know if you've heard of it.
I've heard about it. Yeah. Never tried it though.
It's beautiful. Yeah.
They just send you like all the ingredients, right?
Yeah. And then they tell you how to do it. Okay. But it's dope. Yeah. Cool. So I do it at home, yeah.
Cool, very cool. With the whole graffiti thing, did you like just do the graffiti side of thing, or did you also get involved with like gangs and stuff like that?
I don't want to say I got into gangs, but I was definitely around it a lot. Okay. I don't want to say I was affiliated or anything, but I was definitely involved.
Okay, yeah, because I think that's kind of, you know, growing up on the South Side, me too, like I definitely had friends that chose that path, right? And we were still friends, we were cool, mm-hmm. and I could have easily gone that path too. Oh,
absolutely.
Like it's like one time you go ditching or something, mm-hmm. and your life's like completely
absolutely.
Different.
Absolutely, that's exactly how it was. Like all my friends that I used to hang out with now, they're either jail or, you know, passed away or whatever. Yeah. But it's definitely like that. Yeah, like it's like one instant in life you could have been something else rather than this, or
yeah, and whatever. You don't think about it,
and
right?
You don't, yeah, you don't think about it.
You could have been just like wrong time, wrong place, and then you just get in trouble just being affiliated.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the scariest part that I don't like to think about, but it was definitely like that.
Okay, so you finished high school? Did you like?
Yeah,
you finished high school, and then you pursued the culinary for a little while, and then you were like, "This isn't for me," or what?
Well, in high school, like I was telling you, I was deep into the graffiti scene. Like, I focused on my craft, but at the same time, didn't care about anybody.
Yeah.
Once I got to Metro Tech, is when my life actually changed forever.
Okay.
I had one of the teachers there. His name was Mr. Britt. So shout out to Mr. Britt. But I was one day, he was a math teacher. I was one day in his class and he told me, why don't you ever do your work?
Yeah.
And I was like, well, I don't care. You know, this is not going to get me anywhere. I don't care about school. And he looked at me and he was like, okay, like you're not ruining my life. Go to the back of the class, do whatever you want. You're just going to be nobody. And you'll probably end up in jail. And I was just like, oh, wow, like he's giving me a reality check.
Yeah.
And back in the day, I was like, all right, whatever, you know, I don't care. But it slowly started getting to me like, oh, wow, like he actually doesn't care, you know. So
he was like legit, like just let you stay in the back of the classroom. Yeah. You're just like sketching.
I was drawing, working on my graffiti. And then one day they were just like, hey, we're going to go fill out applications for college. You're not going. And I was just like, well, why? And he's like, well, you don't qualify. You don't, like, you don't care. You told me that. And I was like, wow. So if I don't do anything with my life, I'm going to be a nobody.
Yeah.
I'm going to end up like a homeless guy or another gangster or cholo, in jail.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't want to be that.
What was the relationship at the time with your parents? Like, were they aware that you were messing up and everything?
Oh, yeah. My dad especially was like the most disappointed. Like that, I think that was the main thing that dragged me as well. Is like, you're just gonna be another statistic, and I didn't want that.
Got it.
So it instantly switched to me, and I was like, I need to figure out what I want to do in my life, what makes me happy, how I can make income from doing art. And went on to that.
What was your plan then? Like when you got that reality check, like what did you start doing differently?
Well, I think it was like a week later, I started getting involved in school, started doing my actual work. And then I started asking like, well, hey, what do I need to do to get credits? What do I need to do to graduate and essentially get out of here? Yeah. And they helped me. Like once they realized that I actually did care, they helped me. I got my diploma. I walked. And then after that, I pursued culinary for a little while. Mm-hmm. I didn't like my life. And then I figured out graffiti scene or the mural art scene was starting to pick up in Oklahoma and realized you could start making money off of this.
So you're like, maybe there's like a real like path here where you're not mm-hmm. getting in trouble, but I'm still doing the thing I love, yeah, right?
Exactly.
And how did you find out about that? Like how did you...
There was a place called Tree and Leaf, and it was a graffiti store. Or okay. Not a graffiti store. It was an art store that sold spray paint that was specifically for doing murals, doing okay. like high-end work. And the guy that ran it, his name was Dusty, or his name is Okie Dust on Instagram.
I think I've seen him. He's the one with like an old school van.
Yeah. So he was the first influence on graffiti to me, kind of okay. like guiding me to the right place. Because I remember I went in there, he's recognized me, and he always just asked me like, hey, what are you doing? You know, and I was just like, oh, I'm gonna go tagging. Mm-hmm. And he's like, well, you know, you can do murals and you can get paid for it. And I was like, what? And then he started guiding me through that. Yeah. And I was just like, wait a minute, there's this other side.
Yeah, that's
and cool. And then he kind of, I don't want to say put me under his wing because he definitely had other things going on, mm-hmm. but he definitely guided me through that.
Cool. I don't know if you want to share like any crazy story, but like probably if you're doing graph, like you probably have to do it like at night, like undercover, right? Can you share like any like crazy story? Like, you know, because sometimes I see like way up high or like above a highway or something, like super dangerous spots, a train, like I see it everywhere.
So, I don't know.
I don't want to get you in trouble.
No, so. I mean, I don't care. I feel like statute of limitations is over because it's been a long time. But
all right.
I'm trying to think.
You don't have to tell us the place, but maybe just the
story.
Yeah.
There was one time where we were on top of like a bridge where there was a highway and we were doing something stupid.
Yeah.
And I think I slipped and I almost went into the traffic. And something happened, but God forbid, you know, God helped me that day. And I kind of went out of that alive. And it definitely didn't get me to stop, but it got me to be more aware.
Yeah. Because I've seen some of those where I just like wonder, like, how do they even get up there? Because
it's crazy.
I'm sure you have to be super fast. You don't want anybody to notice you.
Yeah.
You probably can't bring a lot of like official equipment or safety gear. Yeah. Or anything,
it's definitely bootlegged for sure. I remember, as you can see, I'm not a skinny dude. So doing all this kind of stuff, like jumping on ladders and jumping on fences and stuff was definitely hard for me, but I definitely went through it.
Have like a backpack and
backpack,
a few cans.
Yeah, backpack.
And,
we would be wearing hoodies, backpack, pants, and sneaker running shoes in case something happened, you just take off.
Yeah. How do you get like, so I always wonder this about too, like, how do you get like fine lines versus like, cause every time that mm-hmm. I've tried to spray paint something like just random, it always like blows out. Right.
Yeah.
So I don't know how you get like curves and fine, like, especially if you're doing like fonts and stuff like that. Yeah. Like,
so that's my specialty. I do a bunch of fonts, kind of like letter work. Okay. I do a bunch of characters. So there's different cap sizes. Some can be skinnier than others. Some could be fatter than others. But it all comes down to can control, how far you are from the wall, how the pressure of the can you want to spray out.
I see.
There's a bunch of different variables, but it all comes down to the size, how far you are from the wall. Because if you spray it from this far, it's gonna spray wide. Cool. But if you're spraying this close, it's gonna spray like this thin. Okay. So,
yeah. Because I mean, I always see like the lines are like super precise, you know, and then there's like shading. And, like, I'm always like amazed.
It definitely gets intricate for sure.
Like, some of that stuff, you see it and you're like, man, if this was somewhere else, like it would be like considered art, right? Yeah. Like it would be, it is art, but because it's like done in sort of a, I guess, illegal, unapproved, yeah, right? Legal way.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't get valued as much,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. So I feel like people started valuing it after like Banksy.
Yeah.
He did all his stuff illegally and people just started taking the wall and putting it into mural, right, into galleries. So,
yeah.
But yeah, you definitely have a point. There's a bunch of dope artists that just don't care. They just want to do it illegally. They don't like doing legal stuff.
Yeah.
And that's perfectly fine. But I feel like if you want to get paid for it, you should definitely start doing legal stuff.
Right. Now that you mentioned Banksy, are there any like artists that like are kind of your influences? Like,
yeah.
Like what would you say are some of your influences?
I don't know if you ever heard, but Mr. Cartoon.
Yeah, he's the West Coast guy, right?
Yeah, he's from LA, I think. Yeah, LA.
Doesn't he do tattoos too?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think he did graffiti, then went into tattoos, okay, and then started getting sponsors from like big people. But definitely people locally as well, like Dusty.
Okay.
There's another guy named Chris Canaley. There's an endless amount of people here that inspire me and that help me through the way, like guide me. And I am greatly appreciated.
What about music? Like there's always like a connection with hip hop.
Oh yeah.
Are you like a big hip hop head?
Yeah. I mean, I don't want to say I'm a huge hip hop fan, but I definitely listen to it while I'm like painting or whatever.
Yeah. So you got like your headphones on while you're doing it.
Yeah.
And stuff?
Yeah. Okay. I definitely have my AirPods on and then I don't like talking to people. So I just get in the zone.
Okay.
Good. Go at it. And then once I'm done, then that's when I'll start talking to people.
Nice. Very cool. Tell me about that transition where you're going like full time, like traditional job. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden you're like, I'm going to do graffiti and this is going to be my career. What was that like?
Yeah, so that's definitely a crazy story. I don't know if you want to talk about it, but
let's do it. Yeah, let's get in.
So I worked at David Stanley. I was a car salesman.
Okay.
Because I was trying to figure out how I could do full time. I hated my life. I didn't like I was good at selling cars, but I wasn't happy.
Right. And it's like not your thing, right?
So yeah,
you're like not looking forward to being at work.
Yeah, right? Exactly. And I just felt like it wasn't my destiny.
Yeah.
So one day I was at lunch. I was scrolling through TikTok and I found a TikTok from Kevin Hart and it was kind of like a motivational thing.
Yeah.
And he just goes off on a story talking about there was a point in his life where somebody asked him, if you die right now, what is your book going to look like? If somebody was to grab a book that was about your life, what would it look like?
Yeah.
Is it going to look like you're living the normal life, going day to day, 8-9 to 5,
right?
You know, paying bills, doing the zombie? Or is it going to be you trying to do whatever you can to make your life how you want it to be?
Yeah.
And after that,
and it was just like a random, like
random.
TikTok just happened.
Super random.
Yeah.
And at the time, as I was telling you, Chris Canaley, he's the, founder of the Plaza Walls. We were in talks for a little while about doing a Oklahoma, like a state job where, I don't know if you've seen, but on Robinson Park, there's those murals. It's a skate park.
Yeah. Yeah.
He messaged me. He's like, hey, we need a kind of like a mentee or somebody to mentor on that project. It was kind of like a requirement, and he thought of me.
So it was going to be like kids that were doing the project? Or
No. It was like three main artists and like an up-and-coming artist
that they
want to like help train to do murals.
Oh, okay. Cool.
And he thought of me, and at that same time, like a day before I went to that lunch and had all that happen, he offered me the gig. And he was like, hey, this is going to take X amount of hours, you know, this and that. And working that car dealership job, it was get up at 8 o'clock in the morning, leave at 11 o'clock at night.
And like Monday through Saturday.
Yeah,
probably,
yeah, Monday through Saturday. Yeah. And at that point, when I seen that TikTok, I was like, so do I want to live my normal life or do I want to pursue this with a guy that's super established and that's willing to help me?
Yeah. At the time, did you already like know like how much you would make, or was it a free gig?
At the moment, I completely thought I was going into it without getting paid.
Okay.
But I was willing to take that risk, you know. Okay. I definitely had bills and stuff, but I didn't care. I knew in order for me to get this opportunity, I would have to go through the lows to get to the highs.
Yeah.
So at that moment, I called my boss and I was just like, hey, I quit. I just straight up.
You didn't give like 2 week notice. No. You're like, I'm out.
I was just like, hey, I quit. And then he was just like, well, why? And hung up.
Really?
Yeah.
So you didn't even like try to explain nothing. No.
I was like, I want to burn the bridge so I can't go back.
Man.
I don't want anybody or any reason for me to quit on what I love.
And he's going to try to convince you.
Yeah.
Right?
He actually texted me and he was just like, hey, if you ever change your mind, we're open for you to come back. Yeah. And I just deleted that message. I didn't want to see it.
You're like blocked.
Yeah. So, I still have him on Facebook, but it was that turning point where I was like, I'm going to pursue my passion, or I don't want to say die trying, but essentially die trying.
Man, that's awesome. Did you, at the time, did you tell anybody about that? Or
I actually, you I was, so funny story. I actually lived with my mom and dad at the time. So I have a twin.
Okay.
So, I tell my brother everything cause we're twins, but I didn't even tell him.
Man.
I told my mom and my dad, like I came up with some crazy story that they fired me, you know, I was doing the right thing, but they still fired me. And they're like, it's okay. We'll figure something out. We'll help you out. But you still gonna have to figure out, get another job, pay your bills and stuff.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. And I never did.
Man, this project that you went to, like how long was that going to be?
It was actually a week or two out, or okay. I think it was like 2 or 3 weeks out actually.
Okay.
I think I quit in, I quit in February and I think the project started in April. So it was like a month.
Oh man.
Actually. Yeah.
Were you like kind of like second guessing your decision?
It was definitely scary. I was in my room just like, what did I do?
Yeah.
Can I try to figure out something? Every thought that went into my head, I always said, no, you're going to try it. You're going to try it. I don't care if I go into debt. I don't care about anything. I'm going to try it. I mean, I'm 20 at the time. I was 22 and I was like, I'm young. If I do get into debt, I can figure it out to get back out of debt.
Yeah, for sure.
And I just went full blown into it and I didn't care.
So what was that first experience like when you were working officially? Like, was this like the first time you were officially doing it not illegally or what?
No. Well, I've done projects before that. I've gotten to do dispensaries and, you know, the normal mural gigs. I've done it before, but it was all like low money. Like it was either helping a friend out or just paying for the materials or whatever.
Got it.
This was the actual professional job where I had to get insurance, liability insurance.
Oh, man.
I had to get, I had to go under somebody's LLC to work with them and stuff like that.
Official.
It was legit, I had to sign contracts for the city.
Yeah.
Like it was official.
Man, that's pretty cool. And after that, to just like open one door after next how was
so,
that?
Crazy story, right? So, right after the Robinson job, it took us about a month or two to get it done. And the people that I connected with, which is Carlos Barboza, Tony Thunder, and Chris Kennedy, those three guys were the best people that could ever get to paint with.
Yeah.
Because they were definitely guiding me to the right, you know, spaces.
And that just randomly happened because you were going to that Tree and Leaf and you got to
random.
Meet them?
Yeah. So when I went to Tree and Leaf, Tree and Leaf actually closed. Dusty, I guess he wanted to move on to do more things and not really worry about the retail store.
Okay.
So Chris Kennedy was actually starting up the plaza and I would go in there and buy paint from them.
Okay.
And then he was just like, Hey, I know you. So we just kind of built a rapport. But I guess going back to your question about did stuff start stacking up? Right after the Robinson gig, the Oklahoma City Thunder hit me up.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. How does that even happen? Just like randomly on IG?
Yeah, randomly on Instagram. I thought it was a spam.
If you're going to tell me you did the big Steve mural downtown, you know what I'm talking about?
Wait.
With the mustache and all that?
No. Oh, the Steven Adams? No, I wish. Okay. I wish.
Because that one was like a big mural.
I don't really remember who did that one, but okay. I think I do know who did that, but I don't want to say it. But I don't want to look like I'm stupid. But I think they were looking for an artist to do a pop-up shop. And I was in the talks with them. They were in talks with other artists as well.
Yeah.
And it just randomly came down to me, and we made it happen. And then right after that, the Thunder hit me up again to do the Hispanic Heritage Month design for their Latino night.
Okay.
And I created that for them.
Very cool.
Yeah. And then stuff started going.
So you just like had like a lot of projects already posted on your IG. Like, how did they even see your work? You
know? So, I did have a couple of things on my Instagram that I've done for dispensaries and stuff, but the main one I felt like was the Robinson Park one, where people started giving me actual, he's legit.
Okay, cool.
And I started presenting myself as that as well. If they don't ask, you don't tell.
Right, right.
So,
man, that's super cool because in a traditional job, right, you can have a resume, you list where you work and stuff, but if you're more on the artist side, it's more unconventional, right? It's more about what can you show, who have you worked with, right?
That's exactly what it is. It's how do you carry yourself? What your artwork looks like? Do you know what you're doing? And also, who have you worked with?
Okay.
So I guess that's how I got it. I don't really know.
Right, right.
But I'm not super traditional or religious, but I like to, give my, thanks to God because it's crazy. Everything started happening out of nowhere.
Right.
There's no other way to explain it,
Right. And when the Thunder hit you up, were they aware that you were just traditional graph, spray paint?
So I had a meeting with the marketing manager or whatever.
Okay.
And she asked me what can I do? And I told her letters, typography is my, is what I can do.
Cool.
And we kind of lead more towards that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. And then they were what did they have you do? You were just going to do commission work for the guests coming to the games, or was it something that we have an idea. Can you do this?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So it was more like that. So hey, here's our idea. We want you to be 100% free. You could do whatever you want, but this is kind of the guide that we want you to go down.
Okay.
And I created something. They didn't really like it. And I was like, okay, let me tweak it a little bit. Send it back to them. They loved it.
Very cool. Walk me through the creative process a little bit, because in a mural, you have to deal with the larger scale, right?
Oh, yeah.
So do you sketch it before, on a notepad and reference that? Or how do you keep track of proportions and all that, because I would totally mess that up.
Oh yeah, that definitely gets tricky if you don't know what you're doing. So I normally do everything on my iPad before I tell them, hey, this is what I'm gonna do. So I sketch it out and I'm like, hey, this is exactly what it's gonna look like. Do you like it? Yes or no?
That's a lot of pressure to say this is exactly what it's gonna look like.
So funny thing is, I use a method called the doodle grid, and you use basically what it is you use kind of a color that you don't want to use, and that's not too hard to cover up.
Okay.
And you just do a bunch of little doodles, and you take a picture of that, and then you put your design over it on a Photoshop, and it shows you where each line goes.
Okay.
So you kind of follow that. So it's kind of like a tracing.
Yeah.
But it's definitely helpful. Some people use projectors. I've definitely used projectors before.
Okay.
But that's only on commission stuff.
Yeah.
But when it comes to doing graffiti and it's just freestyle. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because I've always wondered about proportions, because I mean, you get there and the thing could be as big as you expected or bigger.
Yeah.
You just never know until you get there. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. So that's why I love to use the doodle grid, because When you take a picture of it, it shows like every little doodle that you've done. And then once you put it over, it's like, okay, your line needs to go here. You match it up to the wall.
Yeah.
You know, stuff like that. So it's definitely technology based. But cool. back in the day, I think people just freestyled it. And I'm like, that's yeah, wild. That's wild.
So once the thunder came calling, did you tell your parents officially, like, hey, this is what I'm doing? Or when did you tell your parents?
So I actually told my parents in the middle of doing the Robinson Park one.
Okay.
And they were not happy about it.
They weren't happy.
No. I mean, they're traditional. So, I wasn't expecting anything like a welcome party. But once I landed the Thunder gig is when my dad actually, my mom and dad were like, whoa. Yeah. This could actually be something.
That's cool.
So the Hispanic Heritage Design, when I did it, they invited all my family out. They invited me out. They presented the design on the big screen.
Wow. So you got to go to the game and like go to the court and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow.
And I actually did a little interview with them as well. They had the interview showing on the big monitor. Nice. It was actually like a really big thing.
Yeah, that's awesome. And congratulations.
Thank you. My dad went and I think he started tearing up.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, like who would have thought this little graffiti fucking artist would, but
man, what did he like say anything to you?
He just kept on saying that he was proud.
That's awesome.
It was the best night of my life. Honestly. Yeah.
Very cool. What about your twin? Like, is he also like in the art side or what?
No, he's actually super into boxing.
Boxing.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's not artistic at all.
Okay.
He's completely opposite of me. Mm-hmm. He likes to work out. He likes to box. He likes to.
Okay.
And where it's me, I like to stay at home, be in my own little like recluse.
More like creative.
Yeah. Like stay away. I don't like people coming into my room and while I'm drawing and stuff like that. So
he's like into boxing, so he's going like untraditional path as well.
I don't know. See, it's hard with him because I've always asked him if he wants to start going pro and stuff, and he kind of puts it off. But you know, maybe one day.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. That's pretty cool. So after the Thunder, like, what did you start doing to like get more gigs? Like, how does it work? You know, I guess once you sort of get more, I guess public art, like maybe people like start contacting you, but. Do you also have to be like a hustler to like try to find new?
It's definitely a hustler mentality. Yeah. You definitely have to be on it all the time, every second of the day. What's next? You know, because it's not like you're not established.
Yeah, right? And it's not a guaranteed.
Yeah,
paycheck,
it's not guaranteed.
Right?
Yeah, like, it's not guaranteed.
It's not like every 2 weeks. Like here's my paycheck.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Yeah. So, when we were working on the Robinson Park. Chris Canaley, the one that was he runs the Plaza Walls.
Yeah.
He actually offered me a job at the Plaza Walls. And he was like, hey, I know you're gonna go full time. I know how hard it's gonna be. I would like to offer you the manager position here at the Plaza Walls just so you can have something stable while you're on your path to doing your murals.
Yeah.
And I was like, heck yeah, like I'll do that. And ever since then, since I've worked at the Plaza, I've gotten in contact with a bunch of artists, a bunch of people that wanted to do murals for me. So it was honestly the best thing that could happen to me because it is in this scene, you want to stay relevant.
Right, right.
So that's definitely kept me relevant.
And the Plaza Walls, they like change it up like every so often, right? Like how does that work exactly?
So at the Plaza Walls, we have... two festivals a year. One of them is called the Milk Crate Jam, and that kind of captures the graffiti, the hip hop culture.
Okay.
And the second one is the Mural Expo, and that is for any artist. You could do portraits, landscapes, whatever you want.
Okay.
And that's more of like a nationwide. Anybody that's from like Florida, Miami, whatever, they can apply and they can come. The Milk Crate Jam is more like local and it's just graffiti based. So people are just more inclined to do characters and letter work.
Got it.
So, yeah.
All right. So let's get nerdy and let's talk NFTs.
Yes.
How did the whole NFT get on your radar? Because I was talking to you, like if you get it, you get it. But I feel like a lot of my friends, I tell them about crypto, I tell them about NFTs and you just see them like glaze over, right? They think like you're like trying to like scam them or something like you're crazy, why are you talking about this?
Yeah,
like were you also into tech or like did it take you a while to like get into NFTs? How did that start?
So I have a friend. His name is Jai. He does a bunch of murals around the city as well. He was like, hey, have you heard of NFTs? And I was like, I don't really care about it. I thought the exact same thing. I was like, I don't really care. And he was like, hey, man, like, trust me, this is the new thing. And I was like, I trust you, man. I'll entertain it. So I started diving into it. And once you dive in, you go in head first, honestly.
I feel like you either get it or you don't, right?
Exactly.
But like if you're into tech and stuff, you definitely see like the potential and you think of ideas of like how to like add utility to the NFT.
Exactly. Right?
But what was it like for you, like when he said, like, you know, get into NFTs, it's the future. Did it start off as just like a art profile, like picture type thing? Or did you like have a roadmap established for that?
So I don't want to say I'm a genius or anything, but so when I first found out about it, I started doing research and I was thinking to myself, what's the best way that I can earn income, but at the same time, build my own community?
Okay.
And the way to do that is a PFP project, which is a profile picture. And that's kind of like creating a character in a bunch of different ways. And people just buy those different variations of it. And there's utility behind it, like a community-based aspect or like educational, which is what we did. Education, just teaching people how to navigate the crypto space, the safety, the not sharing your wallet address, your secret address, all that kind of stuff, kind of teaching people about the NFT world.
Cool. Yeah. And I think a lot of people use it as access too, right? Like, so there's like, you get, you know, exclusive events or access to people's time, that sort of thing. So I think there's a lot of potential. And then there's also a way where you can get commission every time that NFTs like sells, right?
Yeah. So it's like a residual kind of thing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, yeah, that's definitely what we did also. We hosted private events. Our first event was a pre-launch party.
Okay.
And we had over like 300 people show up.
Man,
yeah, it was cool. It was pretty cool. And we sold, I don't know how much, but I think we sold a bunch that night.
Okay.
We kind of did a way where you can pay with your credit card and we would transfer into your wallet. You would just have to pay the gas fee.
Okay.
On top of the NFT fee.
Yeah.
And it worked out.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Who came up with the concept? So tell us, it's called Metaghouls, right?
Metaghouls, yeah.
Who came up with the concept? And I know you're behind the art.
Yeah.
Like, what was the concept? What was the thinking behind that?
So me and my friend, Tony, me and him kind of came together and we're like, we want to create this NFT project. We created the concept, the name, the whole aspect of Metaghouls, and then we brought on more people, and the rest is history. We created the utility behind it. We created the educational aspect of it.
Yeah,
it was definitely experience that I loved.
And you were like the only one responsible for the entire art, so you like handmade each individual character.
Yeah, so I don't want to say I was responsible for all of it, but I definitely handmade everything.
Man, how long did that take? Like, what was that process?
It took like 3 to 4 months straight of just like constantly grinding away at building the concepts behind them. We have custom ones that I made. We have I created like hats, backpacks, hoodies, different elements that we put into a generator and kind of generated it. But everything that was generated was 100% handmade.
That's pretty cool. And we were talking also, geeking out about how your project is Solana-based versus Ethereum because the gas prices are crazy, right?
Yeah. So our mindset behind that was me and Tony got together and we're like, hey, so what are we actually going to do? Are we going to launch on Ethereum or Solana? And we decided on Solana because it was more, since we're more educational based and that was our utility, we wanted to also be easier to obtain. Okay. So when people don't know about NFTs, they don't want to be standoffish because of the gas fees.
Sure.
So we went with Solana because it was cheaper. Okay. And I felt like it was more easier to mint and do all that stuff.
So what's the educational aspect behind that? Like what, like if I buy your NFT, what do I get access to?
So if you were to buy the NFT, we would tell you, hey, join our Discord. Mm-hmm. We have different videos on our Discord on how, do you want to resell it? Do you want to, the security behind it? Don't share your C phrase with anybody. Yeah. Don't click on any links. Also just like updating people on the daily news of crypto.
Okay.
With like Facebook going into the metaverse.
Yeah.
Adidas, Nike. Like all these big companies, and we would kind of keep everybody in the loop.
Okay.
And any problem anybody had, we would always help them with buying other projects.
Okay.
Or yeah, whatever. We would just be essentially kind of like the.
You're kind of like a gateway for them to hop on to NFTs and understand the NFTs and all that.
Exactly.
Right?
If anybody didn't understand what gas fees were, we break it down to them.
Okay.
Like, hey, Jose, I want to create my own NFT project. This is all you have to do. Boom, boom, boom.
Cool. That's awesome. Do you know how many holders you have, like with the project? Or
I don't know specifically, but I know we have over 200 or 300 holders.
Awesome. Where can people find it? Like if they want to go get an NFT?
Yeah. So we have our website, metaghouls.io, or you can go on our Instagram is metaghouls_1.0, and we have a link tree there where you can buy them there.
Okay.
But yeah, it's we like to proclaim the first PFP project in Oklahoma. And
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was talking about my project and like I'm a one man show, right? So it's super hard to like, you know, just come up with the artwork, post them, list them. Like it's a lot of work. So it sounds like you have like a team assembled, right?
Yeah. So shout out to my team. Luis, Tony, Maria, Lizeth, me, you know, that's our team. Honestly, if it wasn't for them, I would probably be in the same boat doing it by myself. But I mean, I wouldn't say it's impossible. It's just definitely more of a struggle. I would be happy to help you, honestly.
Cool. Awesome. Did you also get into like crypto at the same time?
Yeah.
Like now that you like what kind of stuff do you see happening with crypto? What kind of stuff are you into on the crypto side?
I like to do a bunch of like metaverse coins or like Ethereum, Bitcoin obviously.
Yeah.
I have a little bit of Dogecoin, but
nice. Still holding.
Just, I'm still holding.
Needed to go to a dollar.
I'm waiting for it to hit a dollar and then I'm selling.
Yeah.
But I mean, I'm not too much of a crypto nerd, but I definitely dabble.
Yeah, because I'm again with NFTs and crypto. I think crypto is definitely the future. So you've seen like what El Salvador is doing with Bitcoin and stuff.
They made it their national currency, I think.
Yeah. So you can go to El Salvador, a food vendor is like Bitcoin. Accepting Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. That's crazy. That's definitely what I see most states. I think Jacksonville, Florida made their state a cryptocurrency thing.
Yeah.
There's a bunch of other states that are following. I think New York is one. Hopefully, the Midwest can start tapping into that.
Yeah, I think Miami's trying to like be the crypto like city.
Yeah.
You know, they had like the Bitcoin conference and then they even like rolled out like the bull, they've got the Wall Street bull, but they have like a crypto bull.
Yeah, we were actually out there for NFT Miami.
Oh, you went?
Yeah, the Metaghouls team, we all went out there. We did a bunch of interacting, talking to people, getting connections.
Awesome.
I also went out there for the graffiti stuff because Wynwood is the mecca of graffiti.
Oh, okay.
We definitely made connections. It was definitely the best experience crypto-wise that I've ever experienced, just talking to people, realizing that what we're doing here in Oklahoma is kind of crazy. People are more, I don't want to say scared, but they're more... they don't want to reach outside of the box because they're scared of what potentially could happen. But with Metaghouls and our partner MetaWorld, we're kind of reaching out of the box and creating those boundaries because there is no guideline.
Yeah.
We make the guideline.
Yeah.
So
did you meet anybody cool at the conference?
Yeah. So we actually met I forgot his name, but like there was Mark Cuban. Okay. There was another guy there that was pretty big, but I forgot his name. I got to meet them. We actually got invited out there and we helped volunteer. So we were in the back, you know, backgrounds helping out, kind of seeing how it all works. So yeah, it was pretty cool.
No Gary V.
No, Gary V was not there. No, okay. I think he went to the Bitcoin one, but he was not at NFT Miami.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. What he's doing with, and everybody gives him crap because of his artwork, you know, because they're like, just like super like hand-drawn sketches.
Hand-drawn, super.
But you see how much those are going for? Yeah, and they're Ethereum based.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Well, for Gary V, the reason why it's so easy for him is because he's, you know, he's already established. Yeah. He's the guy, right?
Right.
That's why it's so easy for him to just draw, doodle, and sell out for like 10 ETH or something.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's definitely based on popularity. But here in the future, I feel like it's going to go more towards utility aspect rather than PFPs or whatever.
Yeah. And he does like characters that are like the patient panda or something, right?
Yeah,
like
he'll
try to like...
Like stick figures.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
And I think what he's doing too is like a lot of access. So if you hold it, like you get like different levels. Like some will have like a FaceTime with him. Mm-hmm. Some will have like an actual like meeting. Like I think there's different access that he's doing. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. So with him, he's actually been killing it, honestly, because there's a bunch of celebrities that'll say that and never do it.
Yeah.
But he's actually doing it. He's actually putting in the work because he sees what the future holds for the Web3 space. Yeah. So I actually commend him, honestly.
Yeah, I dig it. And I think, you know, you always hear about the stereotypical artist, starving artist, right?
Yeah.
And now it's like, it's the artist's time to shine.
Yeah, so,
I mean, if you're talented in an artistic, whether that be like video, like pictures.
Photography, like anything.
Right?
You can, so I get this question a lot from artists. How do I get started? And honestly, I like to tell them is even if you don't have an iPad or any way to do a graphic design, just take a picture.
Yeah.
It's not that complicated. People like to think it is, but it's really not.
Right.
You just take a picture of your artwork, or if you're doing a mural, take a picture of the mural and just put it on OpenSea.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like OpenSea is the best way. It's like a third party platform that hosts the NFTs and you can resell them and stuff on there. And it kind of guides you. It helps you. Like, hey, this is how you upload it. This is how much it's going to go for.
Yeah. I mean, if I can figure it out, anybody can figure it out.
Well, honestly, if I can figure it out, anybody can figure it out. Yeah.
Do you have like any other friends that are like artistic and you're trying to get them into NFTs too? Or?
Yeah, I have a bunch of friends. Like the guys I was telling you, Carlos Barboza, Tony Thunder, all the, I don't want to say old school people, but definitely old school people that are just like used to doing commission work and that's it.
Yeah.
I always tell artists is the NFT, the reason why I push artists to go into NFTs is because you can always sell it for the price, right?
Yep.
But if it resells for, let's say $1 million and you set your royalties to be 10%. You get a 10% of $1 million each time
every
it sells.
Every time, yeah.
Yeah, it's not like a one-time fee. It's like every time it sells for $1 million, you get $10,000 or $100,000, you know?
Right. And I think what's cool too is like there's like licensing deals that are happening. You know, you mentioned like Adidas.
Yeah.
Right? Like the whole thing that's going on with the Bored Ape. I think there was a guy that holds a Bored Ape and he started a restaurant. Around his board ape. Have you seen that?
Bored and Hungry.
Yeah. So he like started this restaurant and it's all like themed around his NFT.
Yeah.
And like,
smart.
It's really
smart.
Cool because you own the licensing, right? Like you can prove that you own the one of one. Mm-hmm. This is my like art. And then you can do whatever you want.
Yeah,
merch, you know, restaurants.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
Yeah. It's verified through the blockchain. So anytime you say, hey, I own a medical, we can go back and actually see if you own it or not.
Yeah.
So, the same thing with Bored Apes. That's what we implemented. Is like if you want to make your own merch, you want to make your own stickers, go ahead.
Go for it.
Yeah, go for it. We like for you to market as much as you want.
Yeah.
You let us, like, if you want to project your or like do your own project, let us be your stepping stone. Like our community is your community essentially.
That's super cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's really cool, especially like the educational side that you're doing.
Yeah.
Because like, that sort of like. removes that barrier and that fear where people were like, I don't know, I don't understand tech, I don't know what to do.
Yeah. We definitely got a bunch of that. And with my team, I don't want to say mostly me. It's definitely mostly Tony, Maria, Luis, Lizeth, all of them. They're the ones that are pushing it way more than me.
Yeah.
I'm just the artist, man. Yeah. Like I don't like to say, hey, come to me. They're the ones that are pushing the educational aspect, you know, being the reassurance through medicals. And that's why I always give my praises to them, because I just like to create. I don't like to really talk to people about the NFT space.
You're like, I just want to be creative.
Yeah, I just want to draw. Yeah, yeah. I just want to do my murals. So
cool. What are your thoughts about the metaverse? Where do you think that's headed? Because there's a lot of hesitation with that too. Yeah. You know,
A lot of people hate it because of the whole aspect of you getting goggles, you going into a different world than the actual reality of the world. I feel like it's just going to be a niche thing. It's not going to be the thing that takes over. Yeah. It's going to be coexisting with the real world.
Yeah. We say that, but if you see like younger kids, they've been doing metaverse, right?
Oh, yeah,
like Fortnite, Minecraft, like buying skins, they've been doing it.
My nephew, actually, every single time he comes to our apartment, the first thing he wants is the Oculus.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I definitely see it, but at the same time, I like to think humanity wouldn't let, the computer world take over, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's just my opinion. I mean, I don't want to say take it to heart what I said, but I like to think that.
Yeah. Have you ever explored doing anything like VR related art?
Oh, yeah. So with Metaghouls, we actually created our own world in the Oculus, where it's kind of like our own club, I think you could say.
Cool.
And anybody that owns an Oculus can go into it, and we can all hang out in the metaverse.
Nice.
And we've done it multiple times where holders would come in and we would just hang out with holders in the metaverse. We play basketball. We play like card games.
How does that work? Do you have to like go into like a already existing like?
So we created it. We created the world where you can play basketball in it. You could play like card. We could tell each other jokes.
And you see each other's characters.
Yeah, we see each other. Yeah,
man,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Super
cool. It's just like we set a boundary on the Oculus.
Yeah.
And you kind of walk around that boundary, or you could just stay put. We have like a little analog stick that you can walk around with the analog stick.
Okay.
And you could see each other. We make our own avatars. I make mine to whatever I want. You do whatever you want. And we just hang out.
Do you, I don't know if you're on Twitter, do you follow a guy named G Money? Do you know?
G Money, no. I mean, I'm horrible with names.
So there's a guy named G Money, and he was like traditional, like investor, you know, stuff like that. But he got into NFTs. He bought like a Bored Ape, and then he made that his profile. But now, even when he does like interviews and stuff like that, he uses a filter like,
that uses
like you don't know his identity. You just see like
most
his Bored Ape.
Most of the people in the NFT world like to stay anonymous. I mean, that's their, you know, that's their right. They could do whatever they want. But
yeah,
exactly. People like to use their PFP projects as their avatar.
Yeah.
And that's what we're trying to, with Metaghouls, we don't have, we're working towards that, like bringing the avatar aspect to the meta world or metaverse. Sorry.
Got it. Do you have any upcoming projects? Like, I know we got into NFT, but let's go back to real life.
No, I mean, I love talking about NFT. Yeah. So.
You have any upcoming projects?
No, not really. Just commission work. And I'm actually working with Daisy on bringing like Calle Dos Cinco, more artwork to the Calle Dos Cinco district. I was born and raised on the South Side, like I was saying.
Yeah.
I kind of get into the story of, when I was younger, I would always have to go to the plaza or go into the north side to do artwork. And for the next generation, I don't want them to have to go through that.
Okay.
So I kind of want to help cultivate our own art scene on the south side. So right now, me and Daisy are fighting the good battle of bringing the art world to the south side.
Yeah, she mentioned that they're going to have like a traditional like plaza. You find in Mexico, like in the middle of the street.
Yeah,
like, dude, I can't wait to see that.
Daisy's... I like to, every time I give a chance to give Daisy her flowers, she's a badass. I definitely couldn't do it without her. She's definitely helped me try to talk to the, you know, Caído Cinco district and bringing, you know, the art scene to the South Side, you know, so yeah.
Very cool. I always ask my guests to tell me something about themselves that most people don't know. So, you know, I'm going to put you on the spot here. Tell me something that most people don't know about you.
Well, I don't want to. Well, now we know. I was going to say the culinary school thing.
Okay.
So okay. I was actually a chef. Well, no, not a chef. Sorry. I was actually in culinary school, graduated and went on to do culinary for a little while.
Yeah.
For like 2 or 3 years after high school. And then I quit, did art. So
no medical in Hungary coming in the future?
Honestly, if I get the opportunity, maybe. I'm not canceling it out entirely. So I definitely like to keep my options open.
Very cool. So we are getting the signal here that we hit our mark. And I feel like we just started. We have so much that we need to talk about.
I can go all day long. So
we're definitely going to have to invite you back.
Oh, yeah, man.
But for people that are interested in your artwork, that are interested in, you know, finding out about your projects, plug in your social media. Where can they find you?
Yeah. So I'm mainly on Instagram with my artwork. It's Jose S.
We can pull it up if
you
want.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let me pull it. I'm horrible. I'm horrible with this stuff. But
let's get it right.
It's just Jose Scott 13.
Jose Scott 13.
Yeah. And on Metagools, it's Metagools underscore 1.0. I definitely, if you're into crypto and if you're starting to do crypto, you know, first time, I definitely recommend getting into our community. We 100% help anybody out their projects, whatever they want to do.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to probably hit you up with some questions because I'm trying to get my little NFT project out.
Oh, yeah, man. I love to help. I love to see more people getting into the space because, I mean, like we always say in Metagools, the Midwest is always the last to know everything. Yeah. So we want to be the first to know about NFTs and provide that value to Oklahoma.
I like that. So we're going to wrap it up with maybe if someone is interested in being an artist, is, you know, sort of like, you know, dreaming about the potential of doing that full time, like what would you tell that person, like advice of like what they should do?
I heard
that you went all in.
Yeah,
so
I mean, obviously I would give them the it's probably the bad thing to say, but I would say just jump in.
Or the right thing to say, right?
Like, yeah, I mean, well, it's because it's not the traditional way, right? A lot of people like to shun that kind of stuff. But I honestly say jump right in. If you're dedicated, if you know that one day you're going to make it, 100% jump in.
Okay.
Don't be scared. I always like to think everything's going to work out no matter what.
Cool. I like that. Awesome. Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen, the very talented Jose Scott on the Maverick Podcast. Keep grinding because in the dream, we trust.